بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين أفضل الصلاة وتم التسليم على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد نورك الساري ومددك الجاري واجمعني به في كل أطواري وعلى آله وصحبه نور اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد الخاتم السبق الفاتح الأغلى والخاتم السبق ناصر الحق بالحق والهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم وعلى آله حق قدره مقدار العظيم يا فتاح يا عليم افتح لنا فتحا قريبا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته الحمد لله. We thank our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala for gathering us together in a gathering in which his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioned. These are gatherings that we remember the beloved, and it is in remembering the beloved that we expose ourselves to become beloved to Allah jalla jalaluh, and that we hope that there will be a day that we all experience that in this process of tahabbub that we are now in, i.e. that is what we are doing to try to expose ourselves to become beloved to Allah jalla jalaluh, the greatest of way which is to mention his beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We hope that we all experience today that that caller calls out in heaven is that then indeed Allah loves so-and-so, the son of so-and-so. The command is then issued to Gabriel, who then comes to love that servant of Allah Ta'ala who's here on earth. And then Gabriel commands the angels who are in heaven, and then that servant is given acceptance here on earth. This is a reality, and it continues to happen. It has happened in the past, it happens in the present, and it will continue to happen in the future. And this is one of the great intentions that you and I should make. Every time that we come together to recite praises of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to send salutations upon him and to evoke his name and all of his different names and his traits, and to hear snippets of his blessed life story, and to hear about the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is one of the great intentions that we can make. And then if indeed that we are successful in this affair and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us tawfiq, that we will not take our last breath except that our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with that. And one of the greatest signs that our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala has accepted us is that he's placed in our hearts a special love for his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the first Thursday night, the eve of Jum'ah, the night before the day of the best day of the week that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us about. The very best day of all that the sun has shone upon is the day of Jum'ah, the blessed day of Friday. This is a night, and then tomorrow is the day where we should especially send salutations and salawat upon Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the first one after Ramadan. And one feels the blessings of Ramadan in moments like these, because Ramadan is a madrasa that we learn so many meanings from. It is the practical way that our Lord Ta'ala has given us the ability to learn the meanings of taqwa and to actualize them within ourselves. This is the month of polishing the heart. And when the heart becomes polished, then when you insert in that heart salawat upon the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they are especially sweet. You can feel the polishing that it does, fasting 30 blessed days of this month, and then now being gifted the salawat upon our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is one of the greatest gifts of all. And there are ways that we know that our month of Ramadan has been accepted. And the greatest way is to pay close attention to your heart. And three things in particular, that if you look very carefully at how your heart is when you pray, if you look very carefully at how your heart is when you recite the Qur'an, and if you look very carefully how your heart is when you send salawat upon Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these are the three touchstones, if you will, that we can determine our state with our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's actually very easy. Someone wants to know how you are with your Lord, it actually is very easy. How is your heart when you say Allahu Akbar and you enter into prayer? How is your heart when you're reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And how is your heart when you send salawat upon Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam? And if we look very carefully at each one of these three, we will find that there are degrees. And the key is that you and I, every day of our life, every week that passes, every month that passes, every year that passes from Ramadan to Ramadan, now that this kafara has taken place for these sins that only can be forgiven by fasting the next Ramadan, and the traces of which are palpable at the level of the heart. How is our heart in relation to these three things? And we want to think very carefully about this and to preserve the blessings of Ramadan. But these days that we're in now, these blessed days of Shawwal, and every day is blessed for the lovers of Allah Ta'ala and for His Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. These are especially days that we want to be very careful, because these are the days where it's very easy for us to start developing bad habits that then are going to spoil some of the blessings that we attain during Ramadan. These are days that you have to be especially careful to watch over your heart and to make sure that you get yourself accustomed to doing certain things, even if they be small. The most important thing is that they are consistent. So those various things will be conduits, that, in other words, of how we can preserve the blessings that have flowed to us from the blessed month of Ramadan. And so if you ask about a human being, what you really have to ask about that person is his or her habits. How are their habits? Because essentially you and I are our habits. What are our habits? In our life, every human being has habits. And those habits can be good or those habits can be bad. And sometimes those habits are somewhere in between, depending upon the intention of a particular person. But the key is to develop good habits. And this is from the essence of what our Prophet taught us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have all of these blessed ways on a daily, weekly, monthly, and yearly basis to develop good habits. And if those habits are munawwara, if they are radiant and they that are light giving, then they will profoundly impact our hearts, and that they will help us then that to, as we transition out of this blessed month, to continue to receive the blessings of Ramadan throughout the year. And this was the intention of the righteous. They wanted to devote themselves to Allah Jalla Jalalu in the blessed month of Ramadan in a way that the blessings of that month would carry them throughout the other 11 months of the year until Ramadan came back again. And that these are people that as Ramadan was leaving, is that their heart was filled with sorrow. Because our Prophet ﷺ taught us is that were my ummah to know what is in Ramadan, i.e. the barakat and the rahmat and all of these things that happen in this month, they would have wished that the entire year be Ramadan. Were we only to know what happens that at the metaphysical level, at the cosmic level, that all these different levels of existence, what were we to only to know what happens and the sins that are forgiven and all of the different meanings of it, itq min an-nar, the releasings of the fire and all of the different obstacles in the spiritual path and the hindrances that are lifted and removed, everything that people experience and all the harm that is ward off, were we truly to know the blessings of Ramadan, despite sometimes the difficulty of fasting 29 or 30 days and things that go along with it, we would have wanted the entire year to be that the month of Ramadan. And one of the great meanings of why that Ramadan is in particular the fast is something, it is a form of worship that Allah Himself rewards, is because of what is called sambaliyah, i.e. that this is one of the great ways that we resemble the angels, is by refraining from certain things that are normally permissible outside of the day of the fast during the day of the fast. And the closer that we get to Allah Jalla Jalaluhu, the more then that we will start to resemble the angels. And then the more we start to resemble the angels, this will have an effect on us at every single level, such that we actually become angelic. And the proof of, in the Quran that someone can become angelic, we find in the blessed story of Yusuf alayhi salam. What did those women that were brought in by the Potiphar's wife say when Yusuf came out and they were so preoccupied with his beauty? What did they say? That this is not transcendent you. This is not a human being. That he is only that a noble angel. Ma hadha bashara in huwa illa malakun kareem. This is not that a human being. This is only a generous angel. They saw within him these traces of being angelic, and they recognize that he was special, alayhi salatu wasalam. Then what about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was someone who had a special relationship with all of the angels, and everyone wanted their portion of him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those who were in earth, those that were in heaven, everyone wanted their portion from Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that Gabriel, alayhi salatu wasalam, received the greatest portion of the Prophet amongst all of the other angels, because he was the one that accompanied him that on this blessed journey and up into the seven heavens and beyond to the Sidratul Muntaha, and to the point that he could not go any further. And then, because of his adab with Rasulullah, that the Prophet is that invested him with this great station of khilla, the intimate friend of Rasulullah, but in reality is that he was the intimate friend of Allah Jalla Jalalu, but he that invested him with this great station because he was his companion that on this great journey. So if we that come back and we think about that our relationship specifically to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is very important that we renew our connection to Allah Ta'ala's book. One of the great traits of the people that we find to and believe to be pious people, all of them have a connection to Allah's book. If I think about all of the great teachers that Allah Ta'ala has blessed these sinful eyes of mine to see, all of them had a connection with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you want to speak about Murabit al-Hajj, subhanAllah, this was his weird. La ilaha illallah and Qur'an. He was constantly reciting Qur'an. You would finish your lesson, if there was not another student present, he would say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, and immediately start reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That intimate connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's book. That if I think about my other teachers in different places on earth, all of them have a strong connection with the book of Allah ta'ala. And this should be our goal of every single last one of us. To learn how to recite Allah Ta'ala's book properly. To learn, it does not take that long. Invest the time. This is one of the greatest things you can do. Don't just teach your children. Of course, teach your children from the time that they're young, so that by the time that they reach the age of 7 or 10 or that become of age, is that it's very easy for them to recite Allah Ta'ala's book. But invest the time you to learn the basics of what it takes for you to recite Allah Ta'ala's book. And then that we are taught by the scholars how it is that we need to approach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's book. And the first etiquette of all is to recognize who the Qur'an is from. The Qur'an is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the great statements that the scholars mention, that is actually a statement of one of the offspring of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the great Sayyidina Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. He said, Allah has manifested himself to the creation in the Qur'an, but they do not realize. Allah has manifested himself to the creation through the Qur'an, but they do not realize. In other words, as we're taught by the great Imam Ibn Juzayd Kalbi and others, this is how it was always seen. The Qur'an is an invitation. It is a da'wah from Allah to his creation. It is a da'wah. And that we know in a hadith is that the Qur'an is the ma'dubatullah. It is the table spread. And just as a table spread gathers all different types of beautiful food and things that you can that put in your body, as it likewise the Qur'an gathers all different good that the human being needs in order for us to draw near to our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the number one purpose, is that you and I recite Allah's book. But the first step is to realize this is from Allah Jalla Jalalu. This is from Allah. And once you realize it is from Allah, the next step is to have ta'zeem, is that you exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's book. Every time that it is recited, you stop and you listen very carefully. When the Quran is being cited, it's the time to be attentive. It is a time to shut out any inner speech and then to listen very, very carefully. Not only not speak, that's a given, but also don't speak with inner speech. Listen to Allah ta'ala's book. But this will come first and foremost by having ta'zeem. And as our teachers have always taught, when you hear beautiful recitation of the Qur'an, if you bring to heart that this is from Allah and He is directing it to you individually, this is for you and I, Allah Jalla Jalalu is addressing every single one of us directly. It is a khitab, an address directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you bring that ta'leem to your heart for Allah Ta'ala's book, even if you don't understand the details of the Arabic language, even if your knowledge of the Arabic language is minimal, Allah will open up the meanings of the book to you. The whole purpose of Allah Ta'ala's book is that you conform to its meanings, to mold yourself to the sunnah of our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who was the walking Quran, in order for you to then receive from Allah Jalla Jalalu. And the good thing is, and this is from His mercy, it is not a prerequisite for you to understand Arabic for your heart to become Quranic, for your actions to become Quranic. Allah can give you, it can cause you to realize the meanings of His book without the Arabic language. Learning the Arabic language is important. Do that as well. Like I just mentioned, at least we should be able to recite it, and slowly we start to increase our Quranic vocabulary. But we should always remember that we can never despair and think that, oh, I can't have a connection with Allah's book because I don't know Arabic. No, when you listen to Allah's book, if your heart is right, He can cause you to experience the meanings of the Quran much better than someone who's one of the great reciters on earth. Allah's qadr ala kulli shay, and that we cannot let anything prevent us from drawing near to Him. Unfortunately, that we let so many things, yuthabbituna, that prevent us from drawing near to Allah Jalla Jalla. Nothing should prevent any one of us from drawing near to Allah Ta'ala. And it all gets back to our mashhad. How do you see things? Do we let other things cut us off? We oftentimes let other people cut us off. We let other things cut us off. Nothing can sever your relationship with Allah except you. Shaitan's plot is ultimately weak. His plot cannot be effective unless we let it be effective. No one can force you to do anything. No one can prevent you from drawing near to Allah except your own self. No one. We have to understand this firmly. And every time that we hear the book of Allah, Ya Rabb, make that a reality in me. Ya Allah, make me put that verse into practice in a way that is pleasing to you, Jalla Jalla. And this is the number one intention that we can make when we hear Allah Ta'ala's book recited. I guarantee you, if you approach the Quran in this way, and if you understand Arabic, khair wa ni'mah. If you don't, when you read the translation of its meanings, read every verse, Ya Rabb, how can I put that verse into practice? And you actually think very carefully about every single verse. And sometimes it's at the level of belief. Other times it's at the level of practice. Other times it's at the level of a character. Sometimes it's things that you have to do. Sometimes it's things that you have to avoid, and so forth and so on. But every single verse of the Quran, think about how can I put that verse into practice? And I guarantee you, meanings will open up to you from Allah Ta'ala's book that are not in the books. Allah Ta'ala will open up meanings for you that might not even be in a tafsir, and how you can put that particular verse into practice. And ultimately, you will find everything that is that you want in Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala's book. Imam Abdullah bin Abi Haddad used to say, is that you cannot be a murid, a true aspirant, someone who is seeking Allah Jalla Jalalu, until you find in the Quran everything yurid, huwa yurid. لَا يُكُونَ الْمُرِيدِ حَتَّى يَجِدَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ كُلَّ مَا يُرِيدِ. No one will become a true aspirant until they find in Allah Ta'ala's book everything that it is that you need. Everything is in Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala's book, but we have to listen carefully, and we have to open up our hearts and our minds to it. So it begins by understanding where the Qur'an is from. And then the next step is to have ta'zeem for Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala's book. And then there are a number of steps after that. This is mentioned in detail. I'm summarizing it. There's 10 steps, and it's mentioned in detail in Imam Hujjat al-Islam Imam Ghazali's that book on the Quran and its recitation. But some of the other important ones are then to have presence of heart. And what presence of heart means is that you don't allow yourself to think about other things. So that you have presence of heart. You're focused. You don't let yourself be dragged into thinking about this or that or anything else. And then there is what is called, and they go hand in hand, but they're different. There's what's called tadabbur and tafahum. Tadabbur is the process of thinking about, focusing on the meanings of the Quran itself, and then tafahum is trying to understand what those meanings actually are. So tadabbur is just focusing completely on what is being recited. And then the tafahum is, what is the meaning there? And how does that meaning relate to me? And once you start to do this, is that you will understand what it meant for our Prophet ﷺ to say, is that the Quran is a ma'duba. And once the relationship opens up between us and Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala's book, then the joy that comes from its recitation is greater than any other. And we want to be people of Qur'an. Oftentimes when you, and this is something that really, I just want to share this, you know, that my experience, when you experience Islam and the beauty of Islam in the places in the Muslim world where this is all still preserved, you come back here to Islam in a place like this is where we're from, the United States of America, and you hope and you wish that some of that beauty could be here. And alhamdulillah, increasingly, it is. It's coming and it's happening. But we have to do more. We have to do more. And we want to be people that are connected to the Qur'an. And not just something, not just have madrasas for young people to learn Qur'an. Yes, of course. But to encourage devotion to the Qur'an. Halaqat of the Qur'an, where we learn the Qur'an, where we're constantly reciting the Qur'an. If we do this, there will be immense blessings. There will be immense blessings not only for us, but also the people that are around us. And then that as we start to experience the blessings of the Qur'an, that inshaAllah ta'ala, our entire lives will change. In closing, I think we have to end for Salat al-Isha. I just want to share one last that insight, that the three verses in Surah Al-Baqarah where Allah ta'ala speaks about fasting being prescribed for us, and then he refers to them in the next verse as being ayam ma'dudat, a limited number of days to ease the load upon us. And then he speaks about the month of the Qur'an in which the month of Ramadan in which the Qur'an was revealed. The verse that comes right after that is very telling how we want our state of hearts to be post-Ramadan. This really is the way that we want to transition out of Ramadan into the new year. What does Allah ta'ala say? وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. And when my servants ask about me, say that I am near. The occasion of revelation, if you look in the tafsir, there's like 8 to 10 different opinions about what was the cause of revelation for this verse. One of them was a Bedouin came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, Ya Rasulullah, is my Lord near to me فَأُنَاجِيهِ, so that I have an intimate conversation, or is he far from me فَأُنَادِيهِ, so that I call upon him. And then this verse was revealed. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَدِيهِ, that I am close. So in other words, is that after fasting the month of Ramadan, the three verses that came are all about Ramadan. You know a lot about a person by the questions they ask. And if you have a radiant heart, you have a radiant question. And what a question. Is my Lord near or far? And this is how they viewed it, and that this was the question they asked. And then it was a means for Allah Ta'ala to say, I am near. And then after that, then we have the three great etiquettes of understanding that Allah Ta'ala is near. أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. May Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala bless us to be from the right Iligadi and to transition out of the blessed month of Ramadan with hearts that are pure, Ya Rabb al-Alamin, impurified, Ya Rahman al-Rahim, purifying. May Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala bless us to have a close connection with His book, fill our hearts with the love of Him and the love of His Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Bless us to be from those who are mu'min, mukthini min al-tilawa, mukthini min al-salawat alayhi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah Ta'ala bless us to move up in the ranks of the recitation of His book and of prayers that are doing them in a way that are pleasing to Him and of sending salawat upon the Habib, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Mubarak to all of you. Barakallahu feekum. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Jazakallah khair, Sidi Yahya. Jazakallah khair, MCC, for bringing us great gift, inshallah. MashaAllah. Barakallahu feekum, Sidi. Jazakallah khair. So, inshallah, I'm going to be making dua. Please say ameen. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وأزواجه وذريته وأهل بيته وسلم تسليما كثيرا اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وصل على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين وصل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين اللهم يا أرحم الراحمين يا رب العالمين كما جمعتنا في هذا المكان مع هؤلاء الإخوة الطيبين ومع فضيلة الأستاذ شيخنا سيدي يحيى نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن تجمعنا جميعا في الجنة اللهم اجمعنا مع حبيبنا المصطفى في الجنة اللهم إنا نسألك العلا من الجنة اللهم إنا نسألك العلا من الجنة اللهم اغفر لنا يا أرحم الراحمين وتوفنا مسلمين وألحقنا بالصالحين ولا تخيب رجاءنا فيك يا كريم. اللهم ثبتنا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا واجعلنا من الراشدين. اللهم احفظ مجتمعنا هذا يا رب العالمين، وبارك فيهم يا رب العالمين، وزدنا من فضلك ولا تنقصنا يا رب العالمين. اللهم نور مجتمعنا ونور إخواننا الحاضرين والحاضرات بنورك يا نور السماوات والأرض. اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا هداة مهتدين، لا ضالين ولا مضلين، ولا فاتنين ولا مفتونين، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم ثبتنا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة يا رب العالمين. من كان منا مريضا فاللهم اشفيه وعافيه. اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين أجمعين. اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين أجمعين. اللهم اشفنا يا شافي الأمراض، اشف أمراضنا الظاهرة والباطنة يا شافي الأمراض. اللهم احفظ أولادنا وبناتنا ونساءنا ومجتمعنا، واحفظنا في مسجدنا هذا يا رب العالمين. اللهم بارك لنا في مسجدنا هذا يا رب العالمين، ووفقنا والقائمين عليه لما تحبه وترضاه يا الله يا أرحم الراحمين يا رب العالمين. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. الفاتحة إلى حضرتك.